It's the red button.
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
It's the one that says record.
It doesn't say record. It's just a red circle.
Oh, do we all need to clap? Or?
No.
We should do
okay, you covered
one.
It. Okay.
Dumb.
But technically impressive.
Yeah, that was like really coordinated.
Yeah. You guys are spontaneous.
Okay, so we are a Fistful of Vinyl on KXLU 88.9 FM Los Angeles, and we're here with our guest, Pat the Bunny, who's a folk punk artist and a generally awesome human being, we're finding out. So we're going to talk to him and ask him questions about the stuff that he does, and maybe he'll say interesting things. Damn it, this...
Yeah. You didn't really, I thought you were going to say, we're a Fistful of Vinyl, and so are you.
They can be, anybody. Yeah, I suppose anybody can be. Because we weren't, and then we just decided we were.
That's all it takes.
So
anyone can start a local syndicate.
Yeah.
I suppose so, yeah. We've set up franchises and stuff.
Okay, good.
Yeah. We get like the Arizona Fistful of Vinyl going.
Yeah.
We'll send you the appropriate digital files to make your own stencils. Yeah, whatever you need.
We are, I'm always so bad at starting interviews.
Before we start asking you things, do you want to talk a little bit about yourself? Just
yeah, maybe that's like the right way to go with this.
My name's Pat. I write songs. I've been doing that for a long time. I don't know what to say about myself ever, cool. Really. Yeah.
Well, you've been involved in a lot of projects kind of in the folk punk realm. We've got
that's true.
Ramshackle Glory, mm-hmm. Wingnut Dishwashers Union. We've got Johnny Hobo and the Freight Trains, and then there's sort of some jump aways that Skunk Ape Circus was one I actually just found out about.
Okay,
that was
fun. That was a fun thing to do.
Yeah, it seems like a fun thing to do.
Yeah, so tell me more about that. Just from like a general curiosity perspective,
yeah,
I want to hear about it.
Yeah, I just saw like that 7-minute YouTube video that's on the internet.
Yeah, I don't know what the video is, but cool. As far as the story of the thing, the place to start would be with the Skunk Ape itself. That's where to start the story. The Skunk Ape is the regional species of Sasquatch that lives in the Florida Everglades. Most people are familiar with Bigfoot and say the Pacific Northwest. Skunk Ape is, Bigfoot, but for the Everglades, it's a little shorter. It's about 7 feet instead of 9 feet tall. There's a man who lives in a town called Choppy, Florida, very, very South Florida, as far as you can go, pretty much. 11 people live in the town. He is a man who has devoted his life to skunk ape research. He saw it. He saw skunk ape when he was a kid, saw skunk ape again when he was an adult, and has been, trying to, track down real scientific evidence,
get
the facts about the skunk ape ever since. And I heard about this from some people that I knew in the folk punk community who, I don't know how they, and I think there was a documentary made about him, and I think the people I knew saw the documentary and, were on tour in Florida anyway and decided to stop by and kind of made friends with the guy and said he was like a cool guy, and they told me about it, and I just thought, this is something that we should spread the word about. We should let people know about the skunk ape and the man who's devoted his life to the skunk ape. And so at first we were thinking our bands will go on tour together and we'll kind of talk about the skunk ape or something, but we realized that just didn't really do justice to how grand, this man and his mission is. And so the only thing we could do really would be to start a circus in honor of the skunk ape and the man, Dave Sheely, who has devoted his life to finding it. And so, yeah, we started a circus, and we went on tour from Vermont, up where I was living at the time, all the way down to Choppy, Florida. And we met with Dave Sheely and saw his research lab and all of it. Yeah, it was very
fun. Did he have any convincing information?
I will admit that I didn't come away feeling like he had very convincing.
Like, definitely skunk ape exists.
So there's a lot of potential for his argument is what you're saying.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, he said that he had very convincing video that he couldn't show us.
Classified.
Yeah. Man. Well, he didn't say it was classified. He said that he had signed a contract with I forget whether it was the Travel Channel or the Discovery Channel. There was like a major television deal that precluded him from releasing the footage or showing it, before the TV special came out. But this is a lot of years ago, and I haven't heard about the TV special. So
that sounds convenient.
They just want to perfect it. I think it's
hopefully.
Like in the works,
I'm hoping that's true. And it's not even. I believe him that he saw the skunk ape, and a lot of there are a huge amount of skunk ape sightings in that region. So I would agree that there is some weird thing going on, and you could look into it. But I didn't feel like he was actually sitting on the evidence that he sort of claim that he might have, to be real.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Yeah, that's something I'm going to have to look into more. I love, Wait, is Sasquatch like a term for like a sort of legend? Because like, I've always heard it as synonymous with Bigfoot. Is Sasquatch like any sort of like mythical creature that exists in a region?
Well,
or potentially exists in a region?
No, that would be cryptid would be the term for that. There's the there's a branch of study called cryptozoology, which literally translates to something like, you know, hidden animals.
Okay.
Like it's the study of hidden animals. So any sort of mythical creature that is not accepted by science would be referred to as a cryptid. Sasquatch, I think, Bigfoot is more like sort of the colloquial term, and Sasquatch would be more of like, you know, the scientific term.
Okay.
Within the cryptozoological community.
As deep as science goes into that.
Yeah, definitely. Well, my Dane, who plays in Ramshackle Glory, took the one accredited cryptozoology class there is in the country. It's an online course.
Oh,
I forget where it is. It's an online course through some college somewhere. But
he printed his own certificate. 100% certified.
No, I mean, you can't get certified as a cryptozoologist, but you can take one accredited course.
Yeah, which I think is enough.
In the subject.
Yeah, it makes you just...
Do you learn, like, the anatomy of the Bigfoot?
I hope so. I did. I've seen his book, and it's just a lot of entries of a lot of hidden animals and what people found out about them. Because, you know, I mean, the giant squid was a cryptid for a really long time. Now we know that it's real. You know, the Florida panther, it's not an indigenous species of panther, but... So, you know, enough panthers, you know, escaped captivity or whatever, that now there is a population of panthers living in Florida. And, you know, for a long time people were saying, like, I saw a panther, and the Parks Department was like, no, you didn't.
No.
They don't live here,
you
know?
There's no way.
Yeah, there are hidden animals that later are accepted by science.
They're only crazy till they're right.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
right. Yep.
And if you spend your entire life doing it, sometimes, you know, people respect you after you're dead.
Hopefully,
yeah. So I guess on the topic of naming things, less so from a cryptozoological perspective, talk to me about Pat the Bunny. I know there's the book where you physically Pat the Bunny. How did that become your moniker?
Well, that's probably where the name comes from. I arrived at that name. Let's see, I was probably 13, maybe 14, and I played in a very bad hardcore punk band.
And, awesome. I feel like so many good people get their start there.
Our first show was coming up, and you know, I thought we needed merch for our first show. I assumed people would probably be interested in some merch from our band, because you know,
I admire the optimism.
Yeah, like, you know, before I'd ever played a show, I guess I thought it was easier to make music that other people would like listening to than I found out what was true. And so I thought, you know, people are going to want some patches. We should, like, make some patches. But, you know, when I was 14, the only way to make patches I had was, like, a Sharpie marker and, you know, T-shirts and cutting them up. And so me and some of my friends were making patches for my hardcore punk band. And one of them makes this patch. And she looks at me and says, you know, I'm going to give you this patch. But before I do, you have to promise to wear it all of the time. I said, all right, I'll do it. She gave me a patch that said Pat the Bunny, and you know, on my punk hoodie from then on, I was always wearing this patch because I had promised to do it. And over time, that just became my punk name.
Awesome,
cool.
It literally stuck.
Yeah.
Duct taped to you in some way.
Let's see. I want to. So you mentioned when I said like maybe we should get a beer. You said you've been sober for a while now, right?
Yeah, I've been sober a little over 5 years. Yeah.
Cool.
Congratulations. That's awesome.
Thanks. Yeah.
Talk to me. You know, as deeply into that process as you're willing to go. Talk to me sort of about the influence that it's had on your music, both before and you know after the decision to be sober.
Oh well, I mean it was. I mean, a lot of work from previous bands is like pretty transparently and directly about like being a teenager who's drunk and strung out on drugs. I feel like everyone who's listened to it, you know, knows that that's what it's about. So that was my life for a very long time. You know, I was an alcoholic and I was a heroin addict, and that I would say completely dominated and defined my life. When I was about 22, I tried to get sober a number of other times, but. It's stuck this time, at least so far, you know, a little over 5 years, and that, just as being high and drunk all the time totally defined the parameters of my life before, I would say that being sober totally defines my life at this point, you know, like not doing that, it would be difficult for me to think of an area of my life that has not been affected by that, yeah.
Huh. Certainly, and this is an offshoot to that, do you identify as straight edge, or?
No.
Any reason why not?
I guess when I think of, I think of straight edge as sort of, at least on a personal level, you know, I know people who identify with straight edge who aren't necessarily like against other people like drinking or doing drugs, but I would say that at least on a personal level, straight edge is sort of an ethical position. Like it posits that there is something like good about not using drugs or drinking. I don't actually think that there's anything inherently, I don't think there's really an ethical component to it. It's just the way that I drink and that I use drugs is very negative for me and for other people. And so I don't do it. But as far as like people who can just like have a beer or something, like I have no ethical idea about that, you know?
Sure, yeah. So it's a personal as opposed to like judgmental perspective.
Yeah, but I want to be clear that I know that a lot of people who are straight edge are not judgmental necessarily of what other people choose to do. But it's like, like, I'm only sober because I would be dead if I wasn't. Mm-hmm. I'm not sober because, like, I think there's, like, something important about that beyond, like, a very sort of immediate physical, like, survivability and being able to have a decent life. Cool. I don't know if that makes sense.
Oh, it makes perfect sense. And I'm actually very glad to hear you talk about it. I come from the opposite side. I was straight edge for 9 years. Where I didn't drink for 9 years and, you know, didn't do drugs. And I was, you know, for a while didn't have sex, sometimes by choice. Uh-huh. But I eventually stopped identifying with straight edge, kind of for the reasons that you're saying. Not because I considered straight edge to be something that meant, you know, what somebody else was doing was wrong. All I felt like I was doing was what was best for me. Mm-hmm. And it felt like saying straight edge created too much of an ideal that other people perceived as being, you know, critical of any other sort of lifestyle. I eventually just kind of became a fan of, like, everyone should do what makes them happy as long as it doesn't hurt anyone else.
Yeah.
And for me, for a long time, that wasn't drinking. And for everyone else, if that is drinking, far out. And for me now, it's drinking. That's cool too.
No, that's Yeah.
I appreciate the enthusiasm.
I mean, I think that on this sort of topic of the way the drugs can affect somebody's art, one of the people I hear talk about it every now and then is Isaac Brock from Modest Mouse, right?
Okay.
He always, I mean, he says a lot that most of his music is produced because he's like strung out on heroin. Uh-huh. So you said that your entire life has been, or like everything you do now is sort of affected by it, the sobriety, and like it wasn't before, but as far as the musical creating process goes, do you find when you were like strung out, was it easier or harder to get in contact with certain parts of your emotional spectrum? And now is it different or easier or harder?
It's definitely different and it's harder, but I think a lot of that just had to do with being young. Like,
yeah, sure.
When I've never written a song before, I don't have an idea about what it's supposed to be before I've finished. And that allows writing to happen just sort of spontaneously. And then later on, whether you want to or not, you know, I've written a song before, so I have some idea about what it means to write a song, right?
Yeah.
And having done that many, many, many times at this point, there's not a way for me to write as if I've never written before that I've found.
Sure. Yeah.
And so, you know, it probably is partly related to drugs, but also just like there's a way that writing just happened for me when I was 16 that doesn't happen anymore because I'm 27.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Sure.
Now, so we posted online and basically tried to find out if anyone else had any questions for you, mostly on Reddit, because that's where we spend a lot of our time.
I've never spent time on Reddit. What I don't know a lot about it. I've heard of it.
It's like an online sort of like
it's an amalgamator. Like,
yeah, it's basically people find stuff on the internet and all post it centrally to this one place so you can see it all on a list. And there's also a lot of discussion and stuff.
Okay.
But there's like a part of it that's dedicated to folk punk that we're particularly active in. So we posted in there to say like, hey, we're interviewing Pat the Bunny. Anyone want to learn anything? And there's somebody who had a question that I actually found to be pretty interesting. I think I wrote down a little bit. So as you know, as a former addict and somebody who's sober now, and you know, maybe this is built on, you know, this question's like built on an incorrect idea, but I imagine there's people who like come to you and say that like your journey and like your sort of like outward presentation of it has like affected them.
This has happened before.
So. How do you feel about that? How do you react to that? Somebody who's saying like, you know, there's
I have no idea how to react to that. I don't think that it's I can't figure out a way to really if somebody says that, I can't connect with what they're saying to me. I don't know how to internalize that idea. How would I explain it? I guess I feel like if I was able to actually sort of accept what they were saying at face value, I would have a very grandiose idea and self-image that I'm not really interested in having, you know? I know from my experience that's not how the world works, you know what I mean? Like, someone else doesn't actually, you know, write a book or, like, play a song or whatever, and it, you know, you are exposed to it, and you know, and it changes something about yourself. That's not my experience with things. Things certainly like have inspired me and all this sort of thing, but it's all like whatever gets shifted is stuff that is already, you know, within myself, sure. like within my personality. And so it's difficult for me to place a lot of weight on people, you know, saying like that I changed their life or something. I fundamentally don't believe it's true. I don't know how else to talk about it.
No, I mean, I think that was incredibly lucid. It's interesting to hear, especially since I think there's, I've never been addicted to drugs, but I imagine there's sort of like an expectation in sharing something that personal that there like will automatically be like a personal connection if somebody's been through a similar thing.
Oh, I mean, like talking to people who get sober, like I love that experience and talking to them about it. I just like any element of the conversation that tries to give me credit for something is the part that I just can't. I can't connect with that. I don't think that's real, you know?
I got you. Well, cool. Do you want to... There's some... You're better at talking about political things than I am.
Sure. I mean, I think... I guess on the subject of freedom, of sobriety, and then I think sort of it by an extension of it, so this like concept of freedom, there's some flux in the writing that you've done. I mean, from like your past to stuff that you say about it now, but there are lots of lines. One of them in particular that comes to mind is like, freedom is doing what you want, shouldn't we want more than just another beer? Is how that line goes, right?
Or yeah,
close to it.
Yeah.
So it seems like you often are talking about sort of like freedom is such a hard thing to define. It comes in like so many different ways. Do you have some, like, if I was to be like, hey Pat, what do you think about freedom, do you have sort of like a like a tagline, or like what do you...
I don't have a tagline. It would totally depend on what day you ask me.
Yeah,
you know?
For sure.
I don't know. Sometimes I'm, like at times I've been fairly comfortable with, you know, things like, you know, freedom is the absence of limits and constraints. Yeah. But then, you know, I think about that a little bit more and it becomes more complicated. Also, you know, even the notion of, like, I experience the world as an isolated individual, but I don't actually think that that is like a real thing. Like, I don't think that there is like... a component of self that isn't a product of the things that have happened to me, like sure. the people that have talked to me, all of these things. So it's difficult for me to claim a piece of myself as like an authentic and isolated agent that could act.
Yeah,
you
right.
know,
with, yeah, you're not totally autonomous
yeah,
from
totally.
Sort of environmental aspects.
And so that makes it very difficult for me to. That's just another complicating factor towards talking about freedom to me.
Yeah, sure.
Like, I say I want to be free. Who is this I? You know?
Yeah, and like how does that thing participate in
yeah.
some sort of free agency?
Absolutely.
So I guess to get philosophical about it for like one quick second, are you somebody who thinks that could be, that's a possibility? Like, do you believe in free agency as like a creature?
yeah, you know, it totally depends on when
yeah, for
on,
sure.
on when you talk to me. I would say that I at least experience making decisions.
Okay.
This could be an illusion, right?
Sure,
like,
yeah.
you know, maybe like, I don't
the
know.
Classic problem. The
yeah.
Matrix, the 360
totally.
Camera.
It, you know, it may be totally an illusion that I make decisions, but I do experience making them and having some influence over my actions. So
yeah.
from there, it's possible for me to at least subjectively
sort of like you have it.
Yeah, claim some ability towards being free, even if I acknowledge that that might not be real.
Yeah.
yeah I can
yeah,
definitely
yeah.
acknowledge that might not be real.
And that's a dark rabbit hole. I mean, sometimes
yeah.
you have to avoid the like illusory thing. You know? I'm a brain of fat man.
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
What is it, like the hamburger and water argument with electricity?
yeah.
We're tubes.
A series of tubes. Not just a truck you can dump stuff on. There's nothing else I wanted to say.
Well, yeah, I wanted to ask about. So you've been, you know, doing the punk rock game, the punk game for, you know, a good portion of your life now.
Yeah. Yeah.
How have your views, both on punk and sort of like the political extensions thereof, developed over time? And like, what, you know, what's remained the same? What's changed? What sort of new perspectives has age brought?
That's. I mean, I think a lot of it is pretty like, I don't go to shows as much the older I get. You know,
mm-hmm.
when I was younger, that's all I wanted to do. You know, like when I was like 12 to 16 or 17, like every time I heard about a punk show, I always went. I didn't care who was playing. Like if I could have, I would have only really been at punk shows probably. Like if I could have decided. And I don't know what has happened to me, but at this point, you know, I don't very often go to a show unless I'm playing at it.
Mm-hmm.
It's I guess music has become less important to me as I got older. I would definitely say that's true.
Interesting.
And like in the way that you listen to it too?
Yeah. I mean, at this point, I mostly listen to the radio. And I really like the radio, but it's like, it does indicate that I'm not, like, I don't have the drive to, like, search out, like, new bands that people haven't heard of or whatever, you know?
Yeah.
It's just that I used to be very interested in that. And now my interest has just shifted elsewhere. I would say that being part of punk, like, as, like, a group of people, as a subcultural identity, I mean, most of the people that I'm friends with, you know, grew up listening to punk and were very influenced by that and that aesthetic and that, you know, all the philosophy associated with that. It was, you know, like, a lot of them don't listen to that much punk now, but it would be impossible to tell the story of my life without punk, and most people that I'm friends with and close with, it's similar for them. So in that sense, I would say, you know, punk remains very central to my life. Yeah.
And what about the sort of political effects that it's had, particularly like views on anarchy, perhaps?
Yeah. Oh, I mean, I was an.
Did you almost say teenage anarchist?
Well, actually, that's yes. I definitely was a teenage anarchist. I was about to say that I was an anarchist before I was a punk, and that's not entirely true. I was still transitioning out of being a Marxist and into being an anarchist when I discovered punk. But for me, interest in politics definitely came first. And that's actually why I sought out punk. Someone who was older than me, probably like, you know, my mom is a college teacher, and so sometimes I would meet college students, and they would, you know, they would tell me things. And one of the things, it must have been passed on by someone that, you know, went to my mom's college, was that there was some connection between, like, punk and politics.
Yeah.
And, you know, being in junior high and being interested in Marxism, I didn't really know many people who I could talk to about stuff. And so when I heard that, you know, there might be this connection with punk, I saw a flyer for a punk show and I went there. I've since found out that many punk scenes are not that political, you know?
Yeah.
But the one that I happened to go to, like, people were flyering about Bamiya Abu-Jamal and, you know, all these political causes, like, things that I had heard of and, like, you know, been and researched and all this kind of stuff. And being able to see other people my age and meet them and talk to them, like, talk to people in person about these things was very, very important to me. And over time, you know, I grew to appreciate the music, but I would definitely say politics drew me to punk more, like, much more so than music.
What was some of the first political stuff that you read as a kid, or, like, some of the stuff that really caught you and, like, dragged you in that direction?
I probably saw a documentary on PBS about the Soviet Union, and I was interested in the notion of abolishing money. Because I used to play a game called Warhammer. And talking to you two, it seems like maybe you are also familiar with this world. So there was... I should have immediately wanted to abolish money just because how expensive Warhammer stuff was. I couldn't afford to buy the really cool stuff, and so, like, I was always, like, very much at a disadvantage to other people who could, you know, all these things. But really what happened is there was a, you know, there was a local hobby shop, and there was a games day, and, you know, every week you could go down and play Warhammer with people, and I was like, you know, 8 or 9. I didn't really know other people who were interested in things. I mean, I grew up in rural Vermont, so, like, there weren't that many kids in my town anyway.
Yeah, totally.
So I would always go to this games day, and it was really my entire social life. And then one week I go, and it's not happening anymore. They're like, no, we stopped doing that. I said, well, why? And they're like, well, you know, we were hoping it would, you know, increase sales, and it didn't work, so we're not going to do it anymore. And that was the initial sort of prompt in my very young brain of, like, what is money? Why does money run things?
Yeah.
Like, can we do something else? And so that prompted me to, you know, sort of have discussions with my parents. And at a certain point, you know, my mom was like, well, it sounds like maybe you're interested in communism. And then there was this documentary on PBS about the Soviet Union. I watched it, and it was like, you know, communism is supposed to be about abolishing money, but, like, Stalin doesn't seem very good. Like, what's going on here? So that made me want to sort of research the history of communism, and I ended up reading, you know, the Communist Manifesto when I was in junior high, and that prompted a lot of things, and that made me, you know, get interested in the history of the Russian Revolution. And through that exploration, the conclusion that I came to was that the main analytical flaw of Marxism is that it is not skeptical enough of the state, and that's what led me to anarchism.
So idealistic as opposed to practical, in
yeah.
a sense.
Yeah, certainly partly that, yeah. But, you know, if you go back into the history, you know, you have Karl Marx, you know, most people, you know, pretty much everyone's heard of that guy. And then you got this guy Bakunin, who, you know, pretty early anarchist thinker. They're in the same international labor organization, and they're, like, having it out with each other over the question of the state. And Bakunin, I think, to his credit, pretty much predicts the Soviet Union. He's like, if you follow Marx's program, like, the state is going to crush people, it's going to become authoritarian. Anything that establishes itself as a power over the workers, even if it speaks in the name of the workers, is going to devolve into this authoritarian nightmare. And he was absolutely right. That is what happened in the Soviet Union.
Yeah.
So, you know, that looking into that history is initially what prompted me to looking into anarchism.
Cool. We should talk about games now.
Yeah,
well, yeah, I guess so. That
I love games. Yeah.
Cool. So, did you play, which Warhammer games were you playing as a kid?
Well, I played, you know, I played original, I played 40K. The game that I settled on the most, I think because the groups were smaller and so it didn't cost as much money, was this game Gorka Morka, which was an offshoot of 40K that was only space orcs on a desert planet.
Cool.
And it was like little gangs of space orcs and trucks, you know, it was only like 12 person gangs.
Yeah.
And you could fight it out with each other. That was my favorite one. Yeah.
Yeah, awesome. I played a lot of 40K when I was a kid. And I was lucky. I had a friend who was like, I've got all of this 40K stuff. You should come over and play it with me. And so I ended up being like introduced to it because some kid in my neighborhood had a bunch of it, you know.
That's cool.
Such a good, yeah, such a fun game.
And I heard you guys chatting about D&D earlier.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've been dreaming of playing Dungeons & Dragons since I was like 9. And
when did you finally start playing it?
This year.
Cool. Nice. Yeah, welcome to the club, man.
At age 27, I finally played my first game of Dungeons & Dragons.
Okay. I
love
just started
it.
Too.
It's my. I think it's the best
it's
game.
Awesome.
I think
it's
the
so
best
much fun.
One.
Yeah. Like, I think, like you said, the nature of it's like multi-directional creative process. The fact that like the DM does a thing and then all the people are like, well, we're gonna do this thing instead.
Yeah, it's so, I mean, it's so interesting because as the DM, you are constructing a world that you then test against the people that are playing in your campaign.
Yeah.
And as the player, like, you test your own ideas against like the reality being constructed by this DM, and the tension and the interaction between those two things is like, I haven't found another game like that. I mean, obviously other role-playing games are similar in that aspect, but just that fundamental dynamic is awesome.
It's so
semi-hotic. So cool.
Yeah, and we're both, John and I are both huge like lovers of video games. And that's something that, at least like with modern technology, video games don't have the ability to do.
You can't do it.
To be able to sort of create that fluid or sort of like reactive reality.
Mm-hmm.
You know, where if you get into a situation and play it differently than like the DM.
You don't get rewarded for it. Yeah.
I mean, the first.
You don't get rewarded, but it also like, you know, it kind of pivots around you in a really like non-egotistical way.
The first time I DM'd, my campaign is set in a dystopian megacity, the first session of the game, people were playing, and they needed to get some information in order to sort of accomplish a task. And what they decided the best way to do it was to get a job and just work an 8-hour shift. And like as a DM, like I had not anticipated that being something they might decide to do. So I had to like freestyle what it would mean for them to get a job at the place they're applying. You know, like you can't do that with a video game.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, we're gonna stay here and start a guild and hire a bunch of people to work for us.
Yeah,
and
totally.
They're gonna go on quests, and this is gonna be an economic based system.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
One of the players in our game hasn't come to our sessions for a couple weeks, so we just gave him a job and made him make money.
Yeah, he's been working, but he's been
like
cleaning shelves.
Earning
and like,
his gold for a couple
yeah,
weeks.
Where does he work?
He works in a blacksmith shop.
A blacksmith.
Cleaning the shelves.
Yeah, and tying specialty knots, because that's his highest craft.
Yeah, he has, in 3.5, I don't know if this is in 2, but in 3.5, there's a rope tying skill. And he decided to play a character in which he just maxed out his rope tying skill. So it's like a
much
plus
to the
20,
detriment of his other skills.
Yes, definitely.
But
okay.
It's like a plus 25.
Yeah,
like,
so it's very,
every
very
time
one-sided.
We need something tied together, he's the guy to go to. And it's become incredibly effective.
Really,
I never thought how useful him being able to tie knots would be.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
But
that's cool. What does he tie knots to do? Like, what are the situations that's
I think
helped
my favorite thing so far is he has the power to like sort of command rope from like a, you know, a telekinetic perspective. And he wrapped a sword with the end of his rope and kind of used it as a sort of like independent flail, like and that was pretty awesome. I don't remember how effective it was. I just remember being really impressed by the idea.
Yeah. Like, way to go, man. And we tie people to stuff a lot when we capture them. And, like, being able to tie them perfectly to things is super helpful.
Yeah, like, zero
definitely
chance of escape.
Anywhere.
That's cool. Yeah.
What character do you play? Tell me, do you have a...
Well, I'm not... I mean, I'm in and out of town so much that I'm not in any games right now.
Yeah.
I'm on tour too much.
Have you played any classes that you've liked?
Oh, the only character that I have played. I mean, I've played like one-off games as a thief, which I'm interested in exploring more. But I played a wizard.
Okay.
That's what I played in the campaign that I was in.
I've always been a rogue, so the thief element really appealed to me too.
And I don't know that much about 2, but in 3.5 and 4, being a rogue is like totally broken.
Yeah.
You can just do like crazy amounts of damage from a distance.
I wouldn't say 2 is necessarily probably as broken as 3.5 or 4 then.
I think broken's too harsh a word. I enjoy it.
Yeah, right, exactly. As a rogue, it's great.
I love rolling 66s to figure out damage.
What?
Yeah.
Sneak attack, dude.
If I get a sneak attack or...
You roll 60?
60 sixes.
Oh, six. Okay.
Yeah. 60 dice? Hold on, I've got this bag over here.
It's a little broken.
This table.
Yeah, no, that's even just six dice. That's a lot of damage.
There's a really broken 3.5 teleport rogue build where, like, if you're level 20, you get to roll, like, 40 dice.
Mm-hmm.
And you can do, like, thousands of damage every hit. It's pretty cool.
That's what you need to take out gods.
The
goal of my character, I mean, the campaign ended, so I'll never get to do it, but the goal of my character was to kill every god and collapse all the elemental, like, all the astral planes in on themselves and abolish reality.
Yeah.
Awesome. That's such a good end game.
Black hole.
Yeah.
We are nothing.
But, you know, I only got to level 3. I couldn't even, like, summon a fireball yet, you know?
Well, he did it. None of us exist anymore. That's character all sheets, give him.
Yeah.
And we could nerd out about...
Oh, yeah.
Are we getting in and out after this, by the way? Are you down for that?
Yeah, all right,
cool. We're going to keep talking about this. Okay, so I want to talk about the smell, and I know you do, too.
Oh, yeah, sure. I don't know if you remember that show or not.
I do remember the show, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we were there.
We were both at that show, and we had kind of different opinions.
Pretty different opinions about it. Yeah, right. So I was on your side, at least. That's how I... Like,
what? Okay.
I don't know if that's the right way to put it.
What do you think happened?
Okay.
That might be a place to start.
Okay, so we were standing off to the side. There was kind of, like, you know, the smell's a very compact space,
mm-hmm.
and there was, like, moshing that was, kind of hurting the people in the front.
Okay. The show didn't end because of moshing. That's not why it ended.
Right.
Okay.
But I saw that was something that was kind of agitating you.
Yeah. That's something that we struggle with all the time. But, yeah.
The other thing is that there were, like, 4 drunk dudes outside who were attacking people as they left.
Uh-huh.
And they sucked. We actually, like, after the show ended, we actually, like, me and Dan and a couple other people from the show, Dan from Slaying with Tigers, actually had to, like, physically block them from coming inside because they were being chodes. Is that an accurate perception of what happened?
Yeah. And the reason that the show ended is because, and, you know, I wasn't there to witness this, something that, you know, the 4 drunk people or whatever, something that they did caused the people who ran the space to be like, this show is over. And so that was communicated to us. Yeah, that was communicated to us, and we cooperated. I mean, I guess we could have been like, no, fuck you. The show isn't over. But we didn't do that.
No. Yeah. Because, I mean, and this kind of brings up, like, the question of punk rock. Like, so many people think punk rock is saying, like, no, we're not going to end the show. We're going to keep playing. But, like,
punk rock is also
respecting DIY spaces.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, definitely. I mean, the smell has been there for what? Like 20-something
years?
It's been there for forever. And it's in downtown L.A. I mean, it's not in, like, a – in some ways, it seems like a pretty hostile environment for them to maintain that space.
Yeah,
there, you know?
Absolutely. I mean, yes. What is that? Second and Second and Hill? Second.
Yeah.
It's right down the street from the Edison, which I think is hilarious.
Yeah. Super bougie.
So, yeah. I want the smell to continue to exist. I mean, if we were – you know, I don't know. I could imagine a circumstance where, you know – Maybe for some reason we ended up playing at a place that I think should actually be destroyed, and then maybe they tell us to stop and we don't. I could imagine the circumstance.
Sure.
But we were not in that circumstance at that time. Yeah.
No. Okay. And I will admit that we weren't aware of that element of it.
The presentation of the canceling of the show made it seem like you were upset by the environment and decided to stop playing.
No. The people who ran the smell asked us to stop, and
Word.
We agreed to do it. Yeah, I'm not very interested in arguing with people on the internet. So, when stuff like this happens, I'm not gonna get on Facebook and, like, argue with everyone who's mad about it.
Nobody
like,
wins.
That's not
argument.
How I want to spend my time.
No,
yeah.
It's been cool. No, not when there's D&D to be played, man.
Yeah,
cool. Well, I mean that actually, like, kind of settles the debate we'd had. And we had a lot of discussions about, like, you know, what does it mean to, like, end a show for something that's going on somewhat independently of the show? But you know, I get it. Like, I get the protection of the safe space and that, you know, the people who run the smell made the call. And that makes a lot more sense to me. Cool. Line of questioning curtailed.
Complete, yeah. Finished.
Ooh, okay. Somebody, I wrote down the usernames, but they're all scattered around. Somebody on Reddit, you know who you are, and congratulations for getting your question on the air. What responsibilities does a modern anarchist have to society?
Well, okay. I guess I would preface this by saying that I try to be very openly and visibly an anarchist because I think there's value to this. Some people are interested in what I do creatively, and I think just being open about sort of where I'm coming from might prompt people to you know, have questions and try to research answers and, like, you know, maybe come to be exposed to different ideas than they had before. But the fact that I do that that shouldn't be confused for me thinking I actually have any, like, particularly insightful ideas about what to do. I would not say that I'm a particularly insightful theorist. I don't, you know, I quite frankly, I don't know what anarchists should do. Most anarchists I know also don't seem to know what we should do. I'd say a very common feeling among people who believe in radically transforming the world that we exist in is a sense that everything that we have tried to do that in recent history has not worked, and it's very unclear what would. So I try to do something that feels important. You know, that's the best I can operate on. I'm most involved with an international network of prisoner support groups called Anarchist Black Cross. There's a local Anarchist Black Cross in Tucson. That's the group I'm most involved with on a consistent basis. Sometimes, you know, there will be like a march to organize, and I'll help do that, or I'll go to someone's march or that sort of thing. But as far as having any particularly good insights about how to change the world, I don't know.
Well, and I think you nailed it in that, you know, personally, you say I do the best I can. You do what feels meaningful to you, and you know, I think, you know, anarchy aside, I think that's the best anybody can do. Whatever you believe in, just do the thing that you feel like contributes best to that idea.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the things, Jared, the guy who's doing our sound. Thanks, Jared. He mentioned as I was asking about how it sounds and stuff, and he was like, it sounds really good. He's really like putting it out there. You know, he's like really doing it. He's giving it his all. That seems to me, from talking to you today and hearing your music, something that you're particularly good at, or something that you're like particularly interested in, is like always kind of doing a thing at its, like, to its end, or like at its fullest capacity.
How
do you do that? Because I think that's something I'm not particularly good at, and like lots of people struggle with, and like, how do you get...
I struggle with it as much as anybody. Sure. I mean, to be clear, I say I'm an anarchist. In my interpretation of what that means, I am at war with this world, because I am against domination. I think we should end it. That means that pretty much every situation that I enter into is one that I think should be dismantled. I obviously don't go around dismantling everything that I see. That would be the true logical extension of what I think. But I don't think that's really possible for me to do individually. And so I attempt to, you know, come to, you know, some sort of like logical idea about how to do that as best as I can without immediately going to prison for a very long time for no particular reason. So, I mean, I guess I would say I feel like I'm probably in the place that you feel like you're in.
Cool.
So I have a question about shyness, if this is something that you're comfortable talking about. It wouldn't be ironic if you didn't want to. but you were talking to me earlier about how, you know, sort of like the onstage or like sort of perceived persona of a performer, that's very alliterative, kind of can clash with that, with like the actual individuality or like, you know, sort of like true personality or like offstage personality.
Yeah.
And you consider yourself like a shy, like possibly introverted person.
Yeah, I would. Yeah, I would say that that's generally true.
Talk to me about the relationship between like Pat the Bunny, the performer, and like Patrick, the shy person.
Well, to me, there's not. It's probably difficult to talk about, because to me, like, playing music is just one thing that I do, whereas to people who don't know me personally, that's all they know about me, right?
Sure.
So to me, there isn't like a, like some sort of disconnect or tension there. It's just, you know, I am the person that I am, and like sometimes I am that person playing music. So I guess to me, the tension more comes from, if that's the only thing that you know about me, then you develop whatever image you do based on that content. And I think oftentimes when people meet me, they find that I'm not what they expect. I don't think that's because I'm trying to like deceive anybody or anything. That's just how things are. You know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Well, and it sounds like that the onstage persona is sort of extrapolated into the personal life, as if people can know you to a personal extent from what you create and distribute musically.
Yeah. I mean, like the music definitely is like about like pieces of whatever, you know, we were talking about earlier, like what is self, right? But, pieces of whatever that is certainly is part of the music. But also, like, I don't know, if I just narrated what I did every day, it wouldn't be very interesting, you know? Like, most of the time I'm not, like, writing a song. I'm, like, you know, washing my dishes or, like, you know, we're drinking coffee with one of my friends and just, like, making weird jokes that wouldn't make any sense to anybody, even if I did write them, you know? I mean, like, there... being a creative person involves editing out almost everything that you do, you know?
Sure.
So,
although particularly maybe not including washing dishes, perhaps.
Yeah, that was a funny choice, I guess.
Oh, yeah. No, I see. I forget that I've written about that. It was so long ago, you know?
Yeah. Ooh,
well, okay, that actually reminds me. There's something else I wanted to ask. So people have said that you don't like playing old songs. Like
previous
to Ramshackle Glory.
Will not do it.
Talk to me about that choice.
Well, I mean, a lot of it's just about being like a homeless teenager who's strung out on drugs. Mm-hmm. And I'm not a homeless teenager who's strung out on drugs.
Yeah.
So something you just like don't really identify with any longer?
No, I don't really identify with. I mean, like, you know, with Wingnut, Dishwasher's Union, there's some sentiments in there that I would still identify with. But it's very, I mean, it's hard enough to just be like, I don't play any of that music rather than trying to like engage with it in a nuanced way and like pick out like a little bit of it that I like and, you know, rejecting all the rest of it. It's just, you know, I'm interested in playing music that I make now. The other thing is just like, you know, I've played all those songs a lot of times. I probably wouldn't want to play them even if I believed in them anymore.
Sure. Yeah,
but a lot of them I actively like really don't believe in them. Yeah.
And how much do you identify with the person who wrote those songs? Do you consider that to like all be a part of yourself?
Oh, yeah.
Or do you consider that like to be?
Oh, certainly.
Okay.
But as far as like what I, you know, like, just because, you know, there was a time in my life where I might have, like, thrown up on you because I was really drunk, doesn't mean that part of respecting that is that I should throw up on you now.
Yeah,
sure. Absolutely. I'm very grateful that you haven't.
Yeah.
Yet.
Give it some time.
I don't want to make too many assumptions about the rest of the interview. We're going to In-N-Out later, but, like...
Yeah. You know?
In-N-Out has induced vomiting people, I think, before.
Too much. I don't want to talk about that. I still want to eat it.
I do. I love In-N-Out. I think it's really good.
Yeah. What's not to like?
Well, do you have anything else you want to ask? Because I was going to tie it up in our usual way.
I mean, I have some thoughts, I think.
Yeah,
still.
Shoot.
What about some of this? Like in the one of the songs you played today, you say, like, if singing changed anything, they would make it illegal.
Yeah.
What about this sort of concept of trying to face a thing that is constantly unfaceable, right? Like trying to
you
make
like
art
domination.
Like domination or like the creative process that is something, you know, that like maybe won't change anything, or like there's that line from William Dishwasher, which you just said you don't really relate to anymore. But
oh, I mean, some
yeah, sure.
You know,
the something. Like these highways don't lead anywhere, but I think I don't care or whatever. Yeah.
Yeah.
Some of that feeling like, why am I doing this in general? How do you deal with that?
Oh.
Or do you, or does it just drive you crazy?
I lean heavily towards darkness. Like,
yeah.
As far as like people who are like are happy like most of the time, people who aren't, I am not happy most of the time.
Yeah.
You know what
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah.
So I wouldn't say that, you know, I have a good
cool.
way of dealing with that.
Yeah.
Say it
really.
Drives me crazy.
Yeah, I think I feel that.
Yeah.
And then I guess one of my only other questions, I mean, and we can talk about this forever, I think. Some of this political stuff and like your movement from Marxism to anarchism is stuff that I'm interested in. I spend a lot of time like thinking really hard about it in like inside of an institution that's canonized, which is sometimes a dark part.
That's interesting.
Like, I went to school for that.
Yeah,
kind of
okay, that's very interesting.
So I've read a bunch
so
of.
So you know much more about it than me, I'm sure.
I think in a super different way.
Okay.
You know, I know a lot about it in like the post-structuralist French economy way.
Uh-huh.
And like I've read a lot of Althusser, and I don't know if you've read any of that stuff.
I haven't read any.
You probably love
I
it.
I mean, at a certain point, unfortunately, I would say the time that I read the most theory was also when I was knotted out on heroin, so I don't remember a lot of
yeah,
it, you
yeah.
know? I've read a lot of Foucault, and I remember very little actual content. So,
yeah, I mean, I just think it's interesting how it, like, do you have any, so if you read any Foucault, do you have any concepts of, like, how power structures are formed, right? Because I think in the, as somebody who's interested really definitively in trying to dismantle power structures, something like where power comes from, whether or not you're somebody who participates in giving a thing power.
Oh, of course.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, do you have any thoughts on that, I guess? Or
oh.
Like, what does it mean for you to be in a position that, like, in fighting the police, there's something about that that gives them power, right?
Uh-huh. I can see this. Yeah. I would say that's what I would identify as... I'm probably not gonna have the same reference points as you.
Sure. Yeah.
I am certainly influenced by post-left thought
okay.
within anarchist circles, and I feel like one of the criticisms of what is identified as a leftist approach to trying to enact social change is, you know, you spend so much time trying to appeal to authorities in various ways that it. Even the logic of what you're attempting to do just reestablishes authority.
Yeah,
you're attempting to, you know, even if it's as like, you know, out there as like you know, you're demanding the police abolish themselves. It's still, the conversation is defined in relationship to this authority rather than attempting to figure out in a more, you know, I guess more practical way, what would it mean to...
Yeah. I mean, I think it's just a crazy logical problem.
Yeah,
I was reading a bunch of the stuff that you, somebody asked you, like, what kinds of books do you like or whatever, and you had a list of them, and some of them were about, some of the articles I read were about, like, momentary repositionings of power.
Yeah.
And, like, people talking about how they've been sort of given gratuitous opportunity and then being, and then, like, feeling guilt for that and presenting that and how that can, like, give somebody who is oppressed power in moments, you know. And
oh, are you talking about Andrea Smith, the problem with privilege? Exactly. Oh, it's a I would say that is a very interesting article. Yeah. And Andrea Smith, just as a thinker, is very interesting.
Yeah.
She's great. I love her.
And have you read Debt? It's a book that's on my list.
I love Debt.
It's worth reading.
I think it's great. Yeah. Cool. I think it's really, really good. I mean, even if, even I'd say, have you read David Graeber before?
No.
I like his style. Not everyone likes his style, but I think his style is, like, conversational and interesting, and, like, the anecdotes he chooses are, like, good, and, like, it's fun to read him. But as far as, like, the value of the content, I feel like it's a book that once you get, like, sort of the basic argument, you don't necessarily have to finish it if you don't want to.
It's like a monster, right?
Yeah, it's, like, pretty long. I liked finishing it, but if you didn't like finishing it, I feel like just reading the beginning, you'll get an idea of what he's trying to say, probably, and it's a valuable thing. One of the most basic facts that he tries to communicate is that how most people think that the history of the economy developed is just factually wrong. You know? This idea that, you know, people used to, like, barter with each other, and then someone figured out money's more convenient than barter, and then, like, we did money, and then at a certain point someone realized credit is more efficient and easy than physical currency. Graeber postulates through going, you know, both through anthropology, which is his particular specialty, and just, you know, history and all sorts of academic disciplines. He postulates that this is backwards. Like, barter economies don't exist before people use money. And actually, if you look at stateless societies that are non-capitalist, they're not like I'll give
like
you
this is worth a certain amount.
Yeah,
of
they're not like, I'll give you an egg, you give me a shoe. Like, that's not how it works. Like, we know each other, right?
Yeah.
And so you'll just be like, hey, I need a shoe, and I'll probably give it to you because I know that when I need an egg, I'll ask for an egg.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
It's not a formalized exchange. That's, you know, that it's very that, and when you think about it, even for a second, it seems very counterintuitive that you wouldn't be willing to exchange things with your neighbor if you didn't both happen to need something from the other person at that moment in time, because you have a long term relationship with one another.
Yeah, right. Because it would make no sense to rely on having an excess of stuff.
Yeah.
All the time.
That's such, like, a seemingly obvious point now. Like, the lack of symmetrical need.
Yeah.
Would, like.
It makes a barter economy, like, totally, like, it doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
It's ridiculously inefficient.
Yeah, it is ridiculously
inefficient. Like, I guess I'll take a shoe if you need an egg, but, like...
And so you need, like, people need to be used to using money, and then for some reason money disappears, and that's when people barter.
Yeah.
Because they're used to commercial exchange, and the medium for it,
like,
is no longer
quantified.
There. Yeah, you know, like, the Soviet Union collapses, there is no money, like, you have to barter, you know?
This is
a reality.
Yeah.
Well, while we're on the topic of philosophy, and we kind of tie this back into the like the punk element of our discussion, and we sort of touched on this earlier, I want to ask sort of on, like, an idealistic level, like, what does it mean to you to be punk?
It just means to be in a weird group of people who identify with that word. I don't know.
Cool.
Yeah.
I know, at this point,
frustratingly open-ended. I understand that. But
yeah,
like...
and I wish I could give a more satisfying answer. At some point, I probably would have been more idealistic about it. At this point, I'm not idealistic. I hope that I'm not too cynical about it, but really, like, saying that you're into punk just means that whoever else says that they're into punk, you're saying you're into the same thing. And, like, you meet some of those people, and, like, you don't really mesh with what they're about in life. And you meet other people, and you find that you really are, and it's kind of hit or miss. Yeah.
Do you find that it's, like, too general of an identifier then?
Yeah. Oh yeah. No, I'm an anarchist before I'm a punk. Definitely.
Mm-hmm.
No question. That's my primary, like, subcultural scene affinity. Like, that's primarily the group that I'm part of.
Well, and to take this back to, like, the identitive level, like, you are an anarchist and you are a punk, but you are many, many other things.
Oh, of course,
to identify strictly as a punk.
Or an anarchist, or whatever.
Is any singular thing, or is any, like, limited set of things, it seems, is, like, an unnecessary boundary or like an unnecessary, you know, sort of restriction on what it means to be a complete person.
Definitely. And yeah, the fact that I, the fact that I place in my own sense of self, anarchism so centrally probably speaks to some kind of defect in my personality, you know?
Yeah. I think everybody's got that though. Like yeah. it's such a, it's like yeah. a defect in some ways, I think, to try to decide to define yourself. Like I am, yeah. I promise I'm this thing, man. You yeah. know? Cause I think everybody's sort of looking to fulfill roles or uh-huh. yep. be a utility or something.
Oh yeah, definitely. And obviously the, you know, anarchist is its own sort of specialized role that's been defined.
And like such a severe form of utility.
Yeah, and it's very difficult to escape once you're in it, you know?
Yeah.
Same with, like, a lot of people discuss like escaping activism, like as a specialized identity, very difficult to escape once you're in it.
You know? Yeah.
Yeah. And I have no good answers about these problems.
I mean, there's good questions at least. It's
yeah, yeah, that's. I mean, if the things that I do creatively can prompt people to like ask, like become interested in questions, that I think would yeah. be the most, like, as far as what would satisfy me the most, that would be it, definitely.
Yeah, you said sort of a poignant thing earlier, just that like, if only you could get people to think things they've never thought before. You know, I think sometimes that's enough, right? Like, you don't have to give them an answer; you just have to like kind of blow their minds for like 1 second, like let them know there's stuff they haven't considered.
Yeah, I mean, people. Yeah, it's I. I'm glad that people do that for me in my life. That's yeah, for sure.
Cool.
I would be a crippled person without.
So it sounds like we kind of got to wrap it up, but you yeah. were going to ask, I imagine, like, what are you listening to?
Yeah. So our show is such a platform for, you know, promoting artists, particularly artists who may not have like the means or opportunities to promote themselves, especially in like a wide, like, you know, broadcast radio type way. Mm-hmm. We like to ask our artists who they're listening to, that like who's on their playlist right now, and who, like, what artists are important to you that you feel deserve more attention than they've been getting.
Yeah. Well, so I'm not, if I was going to answer the question honestly, I would say the names of a lot of top 40 musicians that everyone's already heard of that don't really need, you know, an additional platform. Yeah. So I'll skip over them. But to be honest, that's most of what I listen to.
I think you should say them. I think that's a part of you. You know, that's
the new Taylor.
If it's what on you, it's on your playlist, man.
Yeah, the Taylor new Taylor Swift album is great. It's, you know, I think it's great. I've loved Taylor Swift since she was a country star. The closer that she gets to pop, the more that I like it, just because that happens to be what I listen to. But aside from that era, that sort of level of things, there's this guy Chesky who's in the hip hop world. He's in the indie hip hop world. He has a new album out that is, well, it's not quite out yet. He sent it to me because we know each other and we went on tour and stuff. But that album is very, very good. I pretty much am only going to find out about music if someone like gives it to me.
Sure.
I'm not the right person to ask, because maybe he's doing something that everyone else is in indie hip hop has been doing, and I just don't know about it because I haven't heard it on the radio. But my sense is that he has made an album that is very very unique and very rich and very interesting for anyone who would listen to it. So I would look up Chesky.
Chesky.
Yeah, he's great.
And then there's always Michael Jordan touchdown pass, right?
Yeah, my brother. He's great. I don't know when he last put out an album. He didn't end up. This life is not as much for him, you know, as it is for me. I mean, really, it might not be for me either. I think I have more of the personality of a long distance trucker than sort of a performer, I think.
Do you expect yourself to be a musician for the rest of your life? Are you sort of like a lifer, I guess, as they say?
I wouldn't commit to that now. Well, yeah. I guess it depends what you mean. I'll probably always, like...
Do you think you'll be playing shows when you're 60?
I'll probably play some shows when I'm 60. I don't know if I'll be on tour very much when I'm 60. I think I'll always make records. I can't imagine, like, not writing songs, you know? That's the part that I really like. I really like writing songs. Shows are... Like, I like playing shows, but writing songs is the thing that is very interesting to me.
Well, man, thank you so much for coming out. This has been really fun. I really loved this interview.
I've had a very good time.
Cool. And, you know, all the songs you played were great. I can't wait to release those. So this is A Fistful of Vinyl. I'm Alec. He's John. That's Pat the Bunny. You know us all very intimately now. And, I don't know. Listen to our show on KXLU live every Monday night at 11 p.m. Pacific time. Grab Pat's new record. Where can they find that?
Oh, you can find it on Bandcamp.
It's a great place.
Patthebunny.bandcamp.com or patthebunnymusic.com. Those would be the two places you can find it.
Cool. Yeah, and I don't know. Thank you for watching. Bye, YouTube.
Perfect.
Cool.
That was really fun. That was like some, I mean, like.
That's for tight shots.
We should fit more things
against
Stanley.
Yeah.
Do you want to
I don't know. Do you just want to shoot some stills?
Cool. Having a concept that strong can be a negative because people are writing and think like, well, the concept's good.
It's so good enough.
It's going to be fine. You know? I feel that way about a lot of it. Yeah. Like a lot of sketch comedy shows, I feel like.
Yeah, for sure.
It's like...
Funny
it's,
sketch.
Yeah, like good idea, but like you didn't like add anything to
it right, exactly.
over the course of the sketch. Yeah.
Too often the problem. We thought of this funny thing and then we filmed it.
Yeah.
We thought of 30 seconds of funny and did it for 4 minutes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we called it Saturday Night Live.
Yeah. It's hard to be funny tonight. You know?
It is.
Yeah. Especially on stage. The pressure in front of people.
I like... Whenever somebody calls me funny... I like freak out and get in my head about it. Yeah, funny looking. I'm super unattractive. Thanks, John. I like as soon as somebody calls me funny, that's like the moment where like I become like really conscious of it, and then I stop saying funny things and just say like awkward attempts at jokes and feel bad about me, and then that person leaves me alone.
That would be a funny thing to say. You just did it. That was so meta.
Well, I wasn't trying to be funny though. I was like, that was sincerity.
Just actual moment in your life.
Is Jared in there? Or are you...
Yeah. Are we good to
go? Oh, I didn't see you. There were stickers in the way.
It was beautiful.
Oh. Well, at least I'm the one editing this.
Unless I do it first.
Cool. Hey,
Jared,
guys.
Jared, is this close enough? Am I okay here?
How's this for me? I know I project. He's moving.
Thumbs up. He thumbs up to me.
He thumbs you up. Thumbs up to you.
He said
he's good. You can bring that closer.
Okay.
Other than that,
we're
good.
Cool. Fresh and easy.
Cool. And did Pat sound track yet?
He was sounding good.
Yeah.
Cool.
I'll just chill. I'll just like.
Alright. We're rolling in there though, so we're good.
Okay. Cool. We're on. Kirk, that one's going, right?
Well, I'm going to make sure. And mute my phone. And we're good here.